A key center for the future of Starship launch cadence is SpaceX's test center at McGregor, Texas. Used for both Merlin and Raptor tests, photos from NSF's Gary Blair in L2 McGregor showed SpaceX had prepared another Raptor engine, with a vacuum nozzle extension on the horizontal test stand. SpaceX Observer has reported, hearing a test of one of Starship's Raptor engines, that lasted more than 5 minutes at the company's McGregor, Texas development facilities. If accurate, it could be the longest static fire of a Starship engine that SpaceX has ever completed in the 2 years since full-scale Raptor testing first began. Whether it was successful or not, a 5 or 6 minute static fire would also confirm that SpaceX is well into the process of qualifying Raptor for Starship's first orbital launch attempts. According to that timeline, 10 seconds shy of 3 minutes after liftoff, Starship's Super Heavy booster will shut down and separate from the spacecraft. Starship will then ignite either 3 or 6 Raptor engines, for a bit less than 6 minutes, to boost itself within the vicinity of orbital velocity. Curiously, the same timeline makes no mention of a deorbit burn, without which the first orbital test flight will technically be suborbital even if Starship is traveling very close to orbital velocity. Regardless, the document confirmed that Starship's orbital insertion burns will be approximately 5.5 to 6.5 minutes long, the maximum stamina required from its Raptor engines, in other words. Rephrased, in its current design, Starship will never be able to reach orbit without Raptor engines capable of continuously operating for around 6 minutes. Up until high-altitude Starship test flights began in December 2020, the extent of Raptor's long-duration capabilities and thus the state of SpaceX testing was effectively a mystery. McGregor typically completes multiple static fires every day, and already performs similar duration testing of Merlin vacuum engines and upper stages, so it's possible, if not probable, that one or several other 5 or 6 minute long tests have simply been missed over the last few months. With at least the first test flight of Super Heavy and Starship set to splashdown, as opposed to a return to a landing site, a large stock of Raptor engines will be required before the engines are expected to return with their vehicles for future flights. Super Heavy will now host 29 engines on its aft, as observed via a photo of a new thrust puck of Super Heavy, and then confirmed by Musk on Twitter. He added that Super Heavy would eventually evolve to hosting 32 engines. The supply line for this engine demand is being focused at the production site at SpaceX HQ in Hawthorne, California. Musk added that Raptor production is approaching one every 48 hours, most likely a reference to one Raptor rolling off the production line every 48 hours. Raptors are then shipped to SpaceX's test center at McGregor in Texas, where they are test-fired to validate the engines ahead of being sent to the South Texas launch site. SpaceX currently utilizes 2 horizontal test bays and 1 vertical tripod test stand, the latter converted from being a Falcon 9 test stand. During his latest fly past, photos from NSF's Gary Blair in the L2 McGregor section spotted Raptors in all 3 bays, including what appears to be another new Raptorback engine. While no sea-level Raptors were seen on the test stands during Saturday's pass, SpaceX has shown rapid pace with sea-level Raptor production in the past, which will be required for upcoming Super Heavy test flights. McGregor has already supplied engines up to SN-74, with that engine seen arriving into Starbase along with SN-72 last week. The Raptor van is making almost daily trips on the Texas highways between the 2 sites, meaning the stock of Raptors already at Starbase could be in double digits. Near the Raptor test stands is a facility that SpaceX is currently using to test Starship and Super Heavy RCS thrusters. On his weekly flight, Gary Blair spotted the potential test stand for these hot gas thrusters, used to steer the ship and booster to their destinations. As Elon Musk mentioned on Twitter, SpaceX currently aims to have the hot gas thrusters ready for the first orbital test flight. The orbital demonstration flight will be the first launch from the OLS, converted from a spare plot of land next to the suborbital pad into a hive of construction activity. The centerpiece of the OLS is the orbital launch tower, which continues to rise into the South Texas skyline, with sections 4 and 5 recently lifted and installed on the tower. The fast pace of construction has already seen section 6 rolled to the OLS, and it is currently sitting next to the tower, waiting to be lifted by the giant LR 11350 crane. Section 7, which could be the last of the matched sections, is already under construction at the propellant production site. However, Brady Keniston spotted the initial construction of another section on Monday. A giant winch, which was taken from Phobos, one of the SpaceX oil rigs being converted to be used as ocean spaceports, has been attached to the base of the tower, and is most likely for the crane on top of the tower, which will be used for Starship and Super Heavy stacking. Already speeding towards completion just a few months after assembly began, the tower's primary purpose is to provide a stable platform, capable of steadying Starships and Super Heavy boosters during final integration. When the two stages combine to become one launch vehicle. Situated a stone's throw from the Gulf of Mexico on the windy South Texas coast, the process of carefully mating two halves, of what amounts to a several hundred-ton skyscraper, will be far harder than it might seem. Though early operations could likely trade refinement for patience and some level of added risk, regular Starship operations will necessitate rapid, reliable, and repeatable mating in almost all weather and wind conditions. In other words, Starship's integration tower will likely be outfitted with arm-like structures, capable of temporarily fixing Starships and Super Heavy boosters in place. Teased several times by CEO Elon Musk over the last 6 or so months, SpaceX or its stubborn leader seem to have decided, somewhere along the way, that the same tower could potentially catch those building-sized rocket stages, too. Recently described as, basically Mechazilla, by Musk, the launch tower's supposed catching mechanism is almost a complete mystery. Based on the CEO's comments, the implication is that some kind of giant, mobile pair of robotic arms will be affixed to the tower's exterior. When catching Super Heavy boosters, Musk says those arms will grab the rocket, just below its Falcon booster-style grid fins. In fact, a prototype of a Super Heavy booster's grid fin section was recently completed at SpaceX's Boca Chica factory, and sports what looks like two anchor-like structures that could be used to secure and grapple the rocket. A bit like the four anchors used to secure Falcon boosters to the launch pad before liftoff and withstand hundreds of tons of thrust, the structures installed between Super Heavy grid fin mounts appear similar but are instead installed near the top of the rocket. Perfect, in other words, to serve as anchor points for cranes or clamps. It's possible that Super Heavy boosters could also land by resting the flat rear end of those hardpoints on the tower's arms. At the same time, catching boosters with the flat end of those hardpoints would give Super Heavy an extraordinarily narrow window for successful recovery, unless its grid fins are also capable of serving as the passive part of the catch mechanism. Known as a drawworks and potentially scavenged from Phobos, an oil rig turned SpaceX sea launch platform, the powerful hoist may be the first part of the mechanism that could allow the tower's arms to roll up and down its exterior, cushion, landing boosters, and function a bit like a crane. Using rail-like structures visible on three of the tower's four legs, the hoist could lift that mechanism like a sort of complex rocket elevator. Ultimately, though, SpaceX's unprecedented Starship launch catch tower will remain a mystery until it's fully assembled and in active use. Thankfully, based on the rate of progress being made over the last few months, those milestones might be just a few months away. For now, the official stance is focused on the progression from SN15's success into the ambitious orbital demonstration flight. As previously documented to involve Super Heavy BN-3 and Starship SN20, those vehicles are currently in the midst of being processed at the production site. BN-3, since renamed Booster 2, by Musk, is being stacked in the high bay. The latest stacking operation involved the aft section, hoisted by the recently installed bridge crane. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.